Hi everyone, welcome back. Today I'm going to just do a couple quick greeting cards with my Schmincke watercolors. Somebody had asked me to do a painting with them. These aren't going to be any elaborate paintings, but I just wanted to quickly do some cards, just some flowers or something like that. I have cut up some of my paper, my Fabriano Studio watercolor paper, which is 25% cotton. This is their lower grade watercolor paper, and I love to use it for cards. And I just took an 11 by 14 sheet and cut these into 4.5 by 5, I believe. I use those standard cards. I'm trying to use up some of these standard folded cards and envelopes that come, and these are like 5 by 6.5, yeah, 5 by 6.5. So then I cut these, I think 4 by 5.5. Yeah, and you can get 6 of them plus a couple ends that are perfect size for making bookmarks. So that's what I did. You end up with 6 of these and then 2 of those. And I'm going to go ahead and tape these down to an MDF panel, and then we'll go ahead and get started. So I just wanted to show you guys quickly, I got a few new watercolor brushes. These are from Jerry's Artorama. These are the Mimic, Creative Mark Mimic brushes. They're supposed to mimic sable. This one already has some hairs that have come out to the side. Right when I started using it, I noticed it, and I'm kind of bummed. I hope that that'll go away, or it will go away when I wet it. But yesterday when I was painting with it, I noticed it kept wanting to pop out once my brush got a little drier. These, to me, I know that Lindsay the Frugal Crafter says she loves these, which is why I tried them, and that they're supposed to mimic sable. To me, these don't mimic sable at all. They're much too stiff, and they're very nylon-like. They're not bad brushes, but I would not say that they mimic sable. So if that's what you're looking for, something that's going to mimic sable specifically, I wouldn't purchase these for that reason. But they're not bad brushes. So I'm going to paint with them today a little bit, and we'll see just how well they work. I think what I'm going to start with here are some blue cornflowers. I really like this with the side view. I don't think I'll be doing a lady. I'm not going to copy this because this is off of Google. I'm just trying to get some general impressions of some cornflowers and what they look like from a top view and from a side view. And then I'm going to kind of
first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to wet my paper down. And I'm going to make some distant coneflowers. So I want to have this all blurred out in the background, kind of like a photograph that would be blurred. And so I'm wetting the entire paper. And then I'm going to mix up some of my blue with just a little bit of that carmine red in it. Just a little bit. And then I will take some of the red and put that in there too. I don't want it too purple though. I want it more on the blue side, more like a blue violet. So I'm just going to take this and I'm just going to kind of put the shapes of some of these flowers in the background all over the place. And they may blur together, and that's fine. I don't care about that. So they're just going to get all over the place. Maybe a little more purple to mix it up again. And then when it starts to dry, I'm going to put just a tad more detail in it. Also, I want to get some green in the background. So I'm going to mix some of my yellow and maybe a little bit of my ultramarine. And I'm just going to sweep that up from the bottom. And then I'm going to let it dry. May just have some of these go in here, in and out. And that's just going to kind of blur together. And then we'll let it dry.
Take a smaller brush.
And I'm going to grab some more of that blue and a little bit of the carmine red. Using one of these mimic brushes. That's a little too purple. There's some green in my blue here I gotta get rid of. Stick it in my green. There we go. Okay. Now I'm just gonna put some edges on some of these, but not too much. This may have gotten a little bit too dry. Okay, now I'm going to start painting some real ones in. And basically, I'm just taking some almost triangular shapes like this, bringing them almost to a point, but I'm not letting them meet in the middle. Because the way they meet is with a purple center. I want the ones in the back to be a little bit, or on the top, to be a little bit taller, and then these to be shorter so that it looks like it's tipping upward and facing me. And then I'm going to take some purple, some of the carmine red with a little more blue in it, and then I'm just going to have them meet in the center like that. And that's all there is to it. And that's one. Now, in order to get one that's got that nice, pretty little stem underneath, I'm just going to take some of my blue again. And this time I'm going to have them sweeping upward like this. And maybe a few down here like that. Real extreme, so that this end is real short. And these are real tall on the sides. Now I need the center to dry a little bit. I mean, I can put some of the purple in, but I want to get some of the purple things to sweep up, and I need that to dry a little bit. I might even just take my hair dryer, my blow dryer and heat gun, whatever it is. There we go. And then I don't like that that's still so purpley. I'm going to add a little more blue to it. Some of these are so super blue. They're such a pretty blue, and I don't have that correct blue in this Schmincke palette, so I'm kind of improvising here. Yeah, I like that much better. And again, I'm going to dry this so that I can put the stem underneath it. In fact, that might be a little bit too much there. I'm not going to be able to get the whole stem underneath, or it's going to change the perspective, and I don't want to do that. I'm going to add a little bit of yellow, just a tinge, to my green to tone it down. And then I'm going to go kind of like a vase shape. And then I'm just going to draw this down like this. I wiggled a little bit. My sleeve got stuck on the edge of my table. There we go. Once this dries, then I'm going to add some dots of red in. And I'm going to use that carmine again for color harmony. You don't want to go with a different red. That dried pretty quickly. So I'm just going to add some red near the top, and then a few dots down there like that. And that's all there is to it. Then the other ones aren't going to show this portion if they're tipping the other direction. So I'll just bring a stem down like that. Now I'm going to go ahead and speed this up a little bit. is I've just taken a watered down blue and basically just added some sweeps of color of the blue to imply these cone flowers up here. Some coming off to the edges like that, just so that there's something there, like this one was real watered down. And then the ones that are distinct are the flowers that are in the forefront that you actually see. So I'm gonna put another one right here, I think. That's not heavy enough though. I need a little bit of red in it, but not much. There we go. Yeah, they're pretty much like blades of grass, a little bit deeper green. So I'm just gonna mix some of this deep green in here and we'll see how this is. It's just a very loose form of coneflower. That's all there is to it. This one, I will just do some daisies. Simple daisies, you guys will like these. They're nice and simple, easy to do for those of you who are just starting out. I'm going to mix up some color. I want to use, since I don't have a warmer yellow, it's like they put two cool yellows in this palette, which is kind of odd, a little bit. I want some of that yellow, but I also want some with a little bit of, I can't get rid of this excess. I want to use that pigment. There we go. I'm going to grab some yellow ochre, I think, to put in it and just to warm it up a little bit and see if that's enough. Kind of gives it almost a gamboge look. There, that might work. And I'm just kind of milking the edge of my brush to save that pigment. Okay, and then also I want some green, so I'm going to grab my permanent dark green or whatever they call it. And I think I'm going to add a little yellow ochre to this as well. Yeah, that's pretty good. You can see the opacity in that green, the way it changed. It lost its transparency. Okay, so now, and I'm also going to use a little bit of burnt sienna and some sepia, but I don't need that yet. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this deeper yellow and I'm just going to make some droopy petals. I want some of that yellow on the edge, though. Oops! These brushes are stiff, but they still hold quite a bit of fluid, and I'm not used to that yet, so I gotta get used to that. Just gonna do that. And I want some of that burnt sienna at the top. These are more like, these are black-eyed Susans, not daisies. I didn't mean to misquote myself there. have to say, you guys, I'm still struggling with this. This paint, this Schmincke paint, is so different with the ox gall in it. If you guys don't know what ox gall is, I don't remember if I explained this in another video or not, but ox gall is something that they add to their paints. There aren't many brands that do that. In fact, this is the only brand I know of that does it. Winsor & Newton does not do this. Daniel Smith does not do this. Mugello Mission Gold does not do it. I don't think Core does it either. I may be wrong on that one. No, because they use that Aquazol, and that's all they put in there. So, and I don't know if the Aquazol has its own kind of flowy kind of thing, but I keep getting these jagged edges and like water lines, almost like blooms, like mini blooms, and I don't want them. I wanted this to be smooth, but I'm struggling because I'm not used to ox gall. And they put that in their paints in order to make it flow. You know, some of you who really love Schmincke paint say you love the way it flows. It just moves across the page. And yeah, that's great. If that's what you like, that's great. But when I add water to this, the amount of water that I would add to any other paint, I end up getting this. See how jagged this is? It's driving me flipping nuts. I keep adding paint to it to try to fix it, and it just does it again. And I don't know if that ox gall dries in a certain place or what, but this one is extremely bad.
I'm gonna take some of my sepia.
Okay, now for the tops, all you're gonna do is put these little flecks coming up, just like that. That's all you need to do, and then fill the bottom in like that. Very, very simple. I'll zoom in so you can see this. I just go like that, adding some little jagged tops, and then I fill in the bottom like that. Okay, now I'm just gonna add some of these stems in. And I want this one to come show a little green up here, then go behind the petal and down, and behind this petal there, and then all the way down. Again, so I'm going to add some leaves right there. Remember not to put them perfectly parallel. They're close, but they're not parallel. So if I don't get rid of that puddle, I'm going to end up with jagged edges on my leaf. So if you have those puddles, that's how you get the jagged edges. Don't want those. At least not in this circumstance. Okay, now I've cut up two pieces of paper at 4.5 by 6. This one's a little bit less than that because it was a leftover piece. And I'm taking two pre-made cards and putting them on their fold. If you see on these, they have an indented fold and an outward line fold. You want to use that indented fold on the outside, which is what you would think it would not be. And I just use a bone folder. It's not bone, it's plastic, but they call them bone folders, to fold that. And I'm going to do the same with this one. And then I'm going to take my paper. I'm going to use this color with this. I've decided to pick up the burnt sienna. And then I'm using the green just to pick up some green in the background of this. So I'm going to do that, but I also want to put a bow underneath that and glue it down. So I'm going to grab, I'll show you what I did on some other cards. You can take a bow and just put it around the entire card on the inside
and tie it like that, which is what I did for this tulip card that I made. And then the other day, I did another one of those landscapes, like that one, this one. I did one on a card. A little bit different, but I did it on a card. And then I taped down the bow underneath here and tied it across. So there's nothing on the inside, but that's how I taped it down. And I did it also on this one. This is a fabric paper, and I just frayed the edges. It takes a while, but you just yank the edges off, and it frays. And I did the same thing. I used the yellow bow to tape it down with double-sided tape, and then it doesn't show on the inside. Several different colors of ribbon, just some narrow ribbon, at Michael's, and they were 50 cents a roll. And you could get other ones that were more expensive, but I just went to the 50-cent ones, and that's a great price. There's a couple more colors I wish I had gotten, but I basically got all the colors under the rainbow, the rainbow colors, red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, violet is what I did. So anyway, I'm going to use the blue on this one, I think, and the orange would be cool on this one, except it doesn't match the paper, I don't think. So I may use this green instead, which would kind of give a complimentary feel to the other. So let me go ahead and glue these down. I'm going to use my 3M double-sided tape by Scotch. This is the brand of tape that I prefer to use. This one works really good, so I just use that on my edges. Better to do it on a surface away from the card in case you run off the edge. And before I tape that on, I'm going to get my ribbon ready. And on that one, I was going to use the blue. And if you guys have an easier way, you can tell me, and then I will share it next time. But what I do is I take my ribbon and... Actually, I'm going to go ahead and tape this down and put it around the whole thing instead. I'm going to go around the whole one this time. So this, I will center, just eyeball it. Looks like I got it on an angle a little bit. And then this is where I want to go ahead and stick my ribbon under. So I'm going to get it where I want it, get the amount of ribbon I want. A little extra makes it easier to tie. You're going to waste a little bit, but that's okay. I mean, to me, it's okay. I don't mind cutting off a couple inches, but if it's not as cumbersome. Yeah, that's plenty. And I'm going to just cut it. I could probably go with a little less here. Even that out. Okay. And now I'm going to go ahead and put the sticky on the back of this, just like that. I want to get this as close to the edge as possible, since this is the part that's going to stick down directly to the card. There. And now I'm going to go ahead and line up my ribbon again. Folding it just to see where I need to... There, that's about where I want it. Make sure I've got it opening the right direction. Now you could tape it down onto the card right there, but I'm not going to bother with that. I'm just going to go ahead, line it up where I want it, and that's all I'm going to do. There, so now it's stuck down behind the card, and then I'm just going to fold this over this way, and I want to give it a little bit of sticky tape just to hold it down. Just like that. Whoops, I'm covering my signature. I may need to re-sign it. And then this one, I'm going to just put a little bit on. Just a teensy bit. Oops, I got it upside down. There. And I'm going to bring that in like that. I'm going to cover up my signature on purpose now and just re-sign it. It'll be easier. Then I'm going to tie this in a half knot and then just tie a bow.
And you can do your rabbit ears, but I find my rabbit ears don't come out the right direction when I'm holding it the way I want my bow to sit. So then I just do the wraparound bow. And I think I'm going to put a little more sticky on here. There, that'll make it easier. There, okie doke. Then I'm just gonna cut my ends a little bit shorter. Like that on an angle. Whoops. And the same with this side on an angle. And then I'm going to tape down the bottoms. So let me flip that up. Make sure you put the sticky on the correct side. Just like that. And then tape it down. See? And then the bow won't come undone. That's my little trick for you. There. And now I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to re-sign it. I'll sign it, I think I'll sign it above. I think that would look better there. So here are the two completed cards done with my Schmincke watercolors. These were also done with Schmincke watercolors yesterday, and I decided not to post the video. I'm not going to put a sentiment in these cards until I'm ready to use them. That way, I'm not stuck with a certain sentiment. Like if I want to use this for a Get Well card and I have a sympathy card stamp inside, then that's not going to work out. So that's why I leave them blank until I'm ready to use them. If I were to sell greeting cards, I would put various stamps in them, whatever the person requested. If they wanted all birthday, if they want all holiday, if they want a mixture of birthday, thank you, sympathy, get well, whatever, I'd do them all. So, and the nice thing with a hand painting is it doesn't matter what's on the front. They're appropriate for any of those. So that's what's really nice about the hand-painted cards. That, and the fact that somebody actually has a well, thoughtful, thought-out gift rather than just a card. I was going to post these yesterday, but unfortunately I had a rough night, and I know that I can't please everybody, but I ask that if you were going to give me some sort of criticism, that you could do it in a constructive way and be nice to me. Most of you, all of my viewers, the majority of you are so thoughtful and nice, and your compliments I really take to heart. Unfortunately, when somebody's aggressive and rude to me, I also take that to heart. And there's a way to be kind when giving somebody criticism. You can be constructive about it rather than just say, you need to do this, you need to do this, you should have done that, you should shorten your videos, you should edit them out more, you should lengthen your videos, you should make more, you know, more videos, whatever. You guys, I'm doing the best I can with what I have. You guys know I have health problems. I'm very restricted on everything that I can do. When I'm editing, I'm usually down on my back on my couch or in bed editing while I'm laying down, and I go through my entire video, I edit it out, then I go back and I try to watch it completely again. Sometimes I skim things and then I miss stuff and I have poor editing in there. I'm not a videographer. I do the best with what I have. So I just ask that you be kind to me. You know, I'm human. I am human, and this is not my job. I'm just doing this to pay it forward. When I learned how to paint, I began by learning on YouTube before I started taking outside classes. And I always said that if I ever learned how, that I would use my own techniques and that I would pay it forward to other people. And that's what I'm doing here. If you don't like what I'm doing, then please don't watch. I'm not doing this for popularity. I'm not doing this for a million subscribers and to get rich. You don't do that on YouTube. I'm not making money. So all I ask is that you be kind. That's why I say be kind to people at the end of my video. I love you guys, and I really want to get along with everyone, and I try hard. I am human, and I will make mistakes. So thank you to those of you who have been so kind to me, and the person that had commented to me yesterday, Cool Mountain Picks, I think is your name, the one that's traveling in the RV all over the country. Thank you for your kind words. If I hadn't had those at the same time I was receiving the nasty comment, that one would have hurt me more deeply. But because of your comment, you really got me through it, and I appreciate it. So, that being said, be courageous, paint with wild abandon, and most of all, you guys, be kind to people, and please, be kind to me too, okay? Have a great day, everybody, and God bless you all. Bye-bye.